We will speak about asymptotics of eigen elements for Laplace equation for Laplacian in domain with oscillating boundary. It is a joint work with Gregory Shishkin from Moscow State University and Rostov Gerdichin from University of Ufa. This problem arises in when we want to modelize or to reinforce the stabilization of, for instance, of a structure, for instance, for a membrane, and then this this implies to study the eigenfunctions and eigenvalues of a problem, and for simplicity we consider the Laplace operator. But I think that this study can be generalized to some other situation. So the problem we consider here is the equation minus Laplacian u epsilon equal lambda epsilon u epsilon. U epsilon is the eigenfunction, and lambda epsilon is the eigenvalue. The domain depends on the domain. Okay, the domain. Initially, the domain is a regular domain, and if we want to reinforce the fixation in a part of the boundary, we add some object, may can be spheres, or here we consider a structure which is represented by the graph of a function. Now the this black part is a small part compared to the scale of the domain, and we are interested in the asymptotic behavior of u epsilon and lambda epsilon because the parameter is very small, and we want to describe what is the asymptotic approximation of u epsilon and lambda epsilon. Okay, if we are interested of the limit when epsilon tends to zero, in fact we obtain the problem without the perturbed domain, and the eigenvalue problem which is simple. Okay, but the question here is to describe an approximation better than the limit, okay, to obtain first or second or order of approximation. Okay, in fact, by this problem we can describe a method which is applicable for at any order of approximation. Okay, this is the subject of this study, is to show how to obtain any order of approximation of u epsilon and lambda epsilon. Then the description of the domain, okay, is the domain, the initial domain, which is perturbed by this part of oscillating boundary, depending on a small parameter, and this part, then omega epsilon now is the union of two domains, the fixed domain with which is omega, and the other, and this black domain which has a boundary depending on a parameter. Okay. Here at left we have the point x1 equal minus half, and at here the boundary gamma 3, the point half, Then we have the boundary, the omega of the fixed domain is composed of gamma zero, the straight line. Gamma one is this part. Gamma two and gamma three are this straight line. Okay. Now, if we see this black part, in fact, it is described by this set, the set of x with component x1 and the other x2 with x1 in this interval, and the second is between 0 and epsilon f x1 divided by epsilon. And as we said, the domain omega epsilon is the union of the two parts. So if we see the dilatation on the small part, in fact we will need to define this semi-infinite strip for xi in R2, xi1 between minus half and plus half, and xi2 greater than f at x1. This is the infinite, semi-infinite strip. With gamma, this boundary is denoted gamma. Okay. Okay, now we are interested in the asymptotic behavior of lambda epsilon and u epsilon when epsilon tends to zero. In fact, I first present the case when lambda zero, which is the eigenvalue, is a simple eigenvalue, and the second case when lambda zero can be multiple. So the result is the following. If lambda zero is a simple eigenvalue of the limit problem, the problem without perturbation, and u0 is the corresponding eigenfunction with norm equal 1, then we have two results. The first one is the existence of a simple eigenvalue lambda epsilon of the perturbed problem which I described, such that lambda epsilon tends to lambda zero as epsilon tends to zero. The second, the more important result, is the first order approximation, is to write lambda epsilon as lambda zero, this eigenvalue, plus a correction term, and with a remainder which is of order epsilon. Lambda one is defined by this expression, which uses the normal derivative of u0 and the integral of the square. And what is c? C is a constant, complicated to obtain, in fact, because c depends on the function f, which describes the boundary. And to obtain c, this constant c, in fact, we have to solve the problem. The harmonic x is the harmonic function in the semi-infinite strip with boundary condition equal zero on the left part of the boundary, gamma, and the normal derivative on the other part of the boundary. And we can have many solutions to this problem with only the two lines, so we add a condition at asymptotics at infinity, which is x is as x2 plus a constant as c2 tends to infinity. So if we make the difference x minus x2, we obtain the same problem with a non-homogeneous condition on gamma, the normal, the homogeneous Neumann condition on the lateral boundary, and we obtain that the difference is constant at infinity. Okay? And what we will generalize is in fact to obtain the other term of lambda epsilon lambda 1 plus epsilon 2 lambda 2 plus epsilon 3 lambda 3, etc. And we can also obtain a result for U epsilon, which is the Eigen function. Okay, to prove the second result, in fact, we can use a method, which is a method of matching of asymptotic expansion. I may be initiated by Ilin and used by many different authors. For instance, by Sanchez Palencia for problems with of perturbations in a fixed domain, but with viscosity small and tending to zero. So the method is the following: we have to define two expansions. The first one is the expansion inside omega, and called the external expansion. In fact, external expansion means expansion exterior to the boundary layer. Then it's at the interior of the domain, of the fixed domain, we can write U epsilon equal U0 plus other term, we can define after. And for the eigenvalue, lambda epsilon equal lambda 0 plus some other terms. So, when we set U epsilon equal U0, U0 is the solution of the limit problem, so this function is defined only in the fixed domain. Then we have to extend this function outside the domain because omega epsilon is greater than omega. How to define U0? In fact, we consider formally the Taylor expansion of U0 in the form du0 dx2 at x2 equals 0 multiplied by x2 plus the other terms. And we denote alpha 0, this first term, and due to the geometry of the domain and the regularity of the function U0, we must have the derivative of U0 at the endpoint equal 0. It's very important to have a limit problem with regularity. Okay. Now we have to define the inner expansion. The inner expansion, asymptotic expansion, so that if we write U0 with a changing variable x psi 2 equal x2 divided by epsilon, we obtain in fact this expression. And by definition, what is the inner expansion? That is the expansion at the boundary layer. The first term must satisfy the boundary condition gamma epsilon, V epsilon equal 0, and asymptotic expansion, and we at infinity. Then the asymptotic expansion will be as this at infinity, as xi tends to infinity, xi 2 tends to infinity. Then U epsilon is in the form epsilon V1, a function unknown, depending on psi, represented by x2 divided by epsilon, and can depend on the slow variable x1. V1 will be equivalent to this function as psi 2 tends to infinity. Concerning this function t1, now if we calculate the Laplacian, we have this expression. The normal derivative of v1 on gamma 3 and gamma 2, we have this expression. So, by identifying the coefficient of epsilon, we obtain for v1 that v1 is harmonic in the semi-infinite strip with this condition on the fixed boundary gamma, the normal derivative on the lateral boundary, and what we add is an asymptotic expansion of v1 in this form as psi 2 tends to infinity. Okay? Now, if I take v1 in this form, where x is, as in the theorem, the harmonic function with an asymptotic expansion, we obtain that v1 is in this form plus this constant cf. This is the asymptotic behavior as psi 2 tends to infinity. This condition holds trivially. So the function v1 now can be constructed by considering the function alpha 0 depending on x1 and the function x depending on the first variable psi. So in fact, to have the two expansion must be equal at the interface, then we need to introduce another term in the external expansion, because by this constant epsilon v1, in fact we have the epsilon v1, for epsilon v1 we have epsilon alpha 0 multiplied by cf. Then we have a discrepancy in the two expansion. To correct this, we have to introduce a new term in the external expansion. So we introduce u epsilon equal u0 plus epsilon u1, and u1 must correct what the discrepancy introduced by the development of v1. So, since x is a small variable, then we can have u1 equal this at x2 tend to 0, we must have u1 equivalent to cf multiplied by alpha 0 x1. So, since u1 is smooth, it is equivalent to write u1, it is a boundary condition of u1 equal this c multiplied by alpha 0, which is the derivative of u0 with respect to x1. So, and for the eigenvalue, we have lambda 0 plus epsilon lambda 1, and now we can obtain lambda 1, which is the correction of first order, by identifying the coefficient of epsilon. In fact, we can deduce this boundary value problem for u1 immediately. It is a function minus Laplacian u1 equal lambda 0, which is noun, u1 is the unknown function, plus lambda 1 unknown, and u0 is noun. So, with this boundary condition we have just obtained, and the normal derivative on gamma 1 union gamma 2 union gamma 3. So, how we obtain lambda 1? In fact, we obtain lambda 1 by a solvability condition, which is a problem, it's not an elliptic problem. This is equivalent to multiply the first equation by u0 to take into account that u0 is of norm 1, and this is lambda 1. And then to use twice the Green formula for this term. So we obtain an equality which can give lambda 1 by this formula, where alpha 0 is the derivative of u0 with respect to x2. So then we obtain lambda 1 and u1 as the solution of the previous problem. And u1 is not unique because we have a problem of eigenvalues. So we can impose a condition to have a uniqueness of u1. Thus, in conclusion, the method of matching of asymptotic expansion allows to obtain the first order correction of the eigenvalue. Now, just indicated to justify the process, to justify this expansion, we continue the process to consider now the expansion, Taylor expansion of U1 in this form, near x2 equals 0. Since U1, x1, 0 equal this quantity, then we add alpha 1, x1, which is this, but alpha 1 is u. Alpha 1 is du1, dx2 at x1, 0. We have this condition since u1 is solution of a homogeneous problem, eigenvalue problem. Then, in fact, we have obtained u1. Now we can see what is the other term in the inner expansion in the Boundary layer. So u1 is in this u epsilon is in this form in the Boundary layer. Epsilon v1. Now we add the second term epsilon 2 v2, and by identifying of coefficient of the same parameter epsilon, we obtain this characterization for v2 as the solution of this problem with v1, which is now in the semi-infinite strip with this Boundary condition. Okay, we have also to add some condition at infinity for V2. So we can obtain the solution of the previous problem by introducing a function depending only on Xi. Okay, this is a problem independent of X1, and which have a solution which is unique with this asymptotic expansion. Then we can consider V2 as this expression, as this solution, which use the function X, and this function X tilde, which is the solution of this problem. Okay, then we have in fact construction for V2 as a function depending of the two variables, Xi and X1. And this function we will have this asymptotic expansion. Moreover, we verify that this V2 satisfies this Boundary condition, Neyman condition, homogeneous Neyman condition on the lateral boundary. And now, how we can justify the approximation of the eigenvalue lambda epsilon? We denote by lambda epsilon tilde this sum, lambda 0 plus epsilon lambda 1. Lambda 1 is explicit. And we introduce u epsilon tilde as this term, multiplied by a truncation function. Which means that, in fact, if x2 is less than epsilon beta, where beta is a fixed parameter, In fact, this term is zero and this is equal one. If we are in the oscillating part, we have this term, and if we are near the interface, we have to use the mixed term. So now we can choose the parameter beta and U2 to complete the description of U epsilon tilde. Now we have a function lambda epsilon tilde, U epsilon tilde defined by this, and we can verify that this function U epsilon tilde is zero on the oscillating boundary, that satisfy a homogeneous boundary condition on gamma 1 union gamma 2 epsilon union gamma 3 epsilon. U epsilon tilde satisfy an equation in this form with epsilon, which is in fact a perturbation of eigenvalue problem, with the remainder f epsilon. If we choose beta in between 2, 3 and 1, we obtain that the norm of epsilon is tends to 0 as epsilon tends to 0 in this form. And for U epsilon tilde, in fact, this is 1 plus small term. So to conclude, to prove the result that lambda 0 plus epsilon lambda 1 is the expansion, we have to justify this by this lemma, which can give, if I consider lambda epsilon tilde minus lambda is zero, in fact, since f epsilon is O epsilon, we obtain the result of the theorem. Okay, I don't, it's very technical, but this is the idea, is since f epsilon in the previous slide is O epsilon, then we obtain that and O U epsilon tilde is not zero, then if we inverse this equality, we obtain that the difference in the case where the lambda zero is a simple eigenvalue, we obtain that this difference is small f epsilon divided by U epsilon tilde, and we obtain O epsilon for the difference. Okay, now I just see we can in fact generalize this result to the case where lambda zero has lambda zero is a multiple eigenvalue. I give the idea and the calculation. The case where lambda zero is a multiple eigenvalue. So I consider that lambda zero is double, and we denote by U zero L, L equal 1 and 2, the eigenfunctions orthonormalized in L2, and then verifying this system, which is when lambda zero is simple, we obtain the previous problem, okay, defined on omega. This is the condition of orthonormalization. We can also impose this condition because we have the basis, to obtain the basis, fixed basis of the vector space of the eigenfunction. And we can also assume for simplicity this condition. Okay, then for the difference with the previous results is, in fact, for lambda epsilon, it's in fact the same, since lambda 1 L is the eigenvalue corresponding to the first eigenvalue, and L equal 2 is the second eigenvalue. This is the expression which uses the derivative of U0L, L equal 1 or 2. And for the first term, we have only this result. In fact, by this method, we can continue the expansion to obtain the expansion, the asymptotic expansion of lambda epsilon L and U epsilon L and at any order. I just give the idea because the calculation can be very complicated. U epsilon L equal this sum for the fourth terms plus a remainder of a series. In this form, this is the external expansion, that is the expansion in the fixed domain. Okay, and for the eigenvalues in this form, okay, all terms, and the inner expansion, that is the expansion in the boundary layer, by introducing the function v1, v2, v3, etc. Okay. Now we can write the equation satisfied by U1, U2, U3. We obtain several systems. The first one is the same as with the previous case when lambda 0 is a simple eigenvalue. Okay. And for U2, we obtain the right side is more complicated. And U3, etc. But this can be written at any order. Okay. For each of this problem, we have to add a Dirichlet boundary condition on gamma 0. Okay. Now I write this condition in this form, alpha 0, alpha I 0 L on gamma 0. With I equal 1, 2, etc. And now alpha I 0 are a known function, and we have to add this condition of regularity as in the first case when we have just L equal 1. Okay, and we also write okay, if I compare this condition with the asymptotic the Taylor asymptotic expansion of UI, we introduce this notation, and now we can solve the problem, for instance, the first problem, by using the solvability in H1 of this problem. So now for the definition of function v1, v2, v3, we obtain a system of Laplace equation with right side different, okay, which can be complicated if we calculate v4, v5, etc. But all these functions, we can see that all these functions can admit explicit solution in the form we introduce x in the semi-infinite strip, x tilde, etc. For instance, we have now to write that the two expansion in the inner expansion and the expansion of U and V must be the same when we are at the interface x2 equals 0. So this can be seen as this condition when x2 equals epsilon xi1 tends to 0, we can have this at first order, at any order. V1 is in this form for the coefficient alpha 0, 1, alpha 1, 0, etc. V2, etc. And we have to add the for this wall, which is equivalent to this expression, as psi 2 tends to infinity. Okay, it's very complicated to for the calculation, but all the calculations are possible in this case of regularity problem. As for the first case where lambda 0 is a simple eigenvalue, we have this expression of V1, V small 1, multiply alpha 0 1 is in fact the derivative of U0 with respect to X2, and X is the solution in the semi-infinite strip. For V2, we obtain this problem with this asymptotic, and if we define alpha 1 0 equal this, we obtain the condition of equivalence as psi 2 tends to infinity. So this justifies the construction of V1. Now of U1 and alpha 0 1. Now thus we construct alpha 1 0 and V1, okay, with this asymptotic solution of this problem with this condition at infinity, so we have unique solution V1. Okay, the function, the eigenvalue can be defined exactly by the same type of calculation using the derivative, the normal derivative of U0L with respect to X2, and C is the constant, which is the asymptotic behavior of x at infinity. To define U1, now U1 L, since we have eigenvalue double, so we can write U1 in this form, where with for L equal 1, L star equal 2, and for equal 2, L star equal 1, to obtain, in fact, the form of U1 in a basis, in orthogonal basis of eigenfunctions. So by the previous equality, we must have alpha 1 1 equal alpha 1 1 tilde plus this unknown constant alpha 0 1 L star, where these coefficients are now known, and this condition is imposed for regularity. So we obtain K I remind that X tilde is the solution of this problem. V2 is defined by this function by a separate variable, and V2 satisfies this problem exactly as in the case of single eigenvalue. But what is different is the calculation of the coefficient of U1 to obtain the second eigenfunction. Okay, this, when we now U1 L, this gives U1 K2 L, we obtain U1 L. Then we continue, we choose U2 L in this form, and we impose this normal, this orthogonal condition, and we can calculate K2 L, etc. And we can make all calculation to obtain all expansions. So I stop here. Thank you very much.
Why we work only in dimension 2?
Why?
We work only in dimension 2.
Ah, just only to the essential the essential point here to have the calculation is to have the regularity at the end point. Because when we use an asymptote, a Taylor expansion on x2 equals 0, and the other we have a normal condition, the normal derivative equals 0. So we have to impose a condition of a matching at this point, at any point. If then this is the regularity for two dimension. For three dimension, you have to impose some other conditions which are different. For instance, for the Dirichlet problem of Laplace equal f with corner, then there are different conditions in two dimension and in three dimensions. The results of Grieve are. Then this the condition of geometry is important to have. If we impose periodicity, there is no this problem.
Grazie a tutti.